I wanted to say before starting this that I do have a purple channel and it's called Roanoke Games, so you should go check that out. All right, anyhow, as people continue to press the boundaries and increase the general knowledge of humanity, it's becoming quite apparent that some areas of science should be more than likely just straight up avoided. Even with these untapped areas holding new technologies and abilities, at what point would it be considered unethical to essentially conduct the experiments where the fruit just isn't worth the squeeze? Well, a general outline to this answer has to do with introduction and hybrid of human genetic material with animal DNA. And if this is the case, then you probably have a clear-cut no. Although even with that thinking, there is room for experiments to wiggle through. More specifically, however, in the events taking place during the movie Splice, two scientists would cross the line and create a being through nefarious means, each with their own interests and reasoning for its creation. However, as the creature grew, it would begin to go beyond their grasp and control. This creature is the result of what happens when human ego and science meet, which honestly yields something that's fairly interesting, and I can't really fault them too terribly because I definitely don't have one of these things in my basement currently. Definitely not, so don't worry about it. But apart from that, today we will be discussing the genetic experiment from the movie Splice and get into its physiology as well as origins apart from human. We will also talk about the genetic combination that it stems from, so oh yeah, it's gonna be a science heavy one, which we haven't really had in a hot minute, so it's about that time. So let's discuss this monstrosity from Splice, shall we? So first things first, I have noticed as of late, I keep getting comments, XD video starts at blank blank go there, which is actually kind of true. The part of the video that is discussing, let's say, the monster does begin at that point, but not everyone has seen the movie, which I discuss and do like a quick synopsis. So this is usually required to get somebody up to the same page. But for those that have already seen it, there will be a timestamp up on screen, so go to that to bypass the summarization of the movie if you want to bypass. But for everyone else who may not have seen this yet, let's jump into what happens when you get frisky with a lab experiment. So it all starts with a breakthrough. Genetic engineers Clive Nicolai and Elsa Cast are doing what scientists have always sought after, fame. In fact, being a scientist myself, I am in a published paper for what I discovered, but my name isn't, so hashtag cog in the machine. But these particular scientists are more interested in gaining notoriety in their field for creating hybrids for medical use. Working at a company named Nucleic Exchange Research and Development, or NERD for short, the two scientists claim to fame was their Veriform, known by the name of Fred. So a Veriform is like a worm-like creature. Fred was a small dog size and was intended to be the mate for their female specimen known as Ginger. After introduction, they imprinted on one another as seen by their internal membranes touching and being accepted. Don't ask what those membranes are. After mating, Clive and Elsa came up with the idea that they could take this even further than just the creation of Veriforms. Their plan was to combine human and animal DNA to revolutionize the science of genetic research, having them squarely at the forefront. Discussing amongst themselves, they figured the best way was to go to their bosses who were backing their entire project. So at this point, you know you are treading outside the realm of ethics when a backroom meeting with CEOs ends up with them basically telling you flat out no. Their idea to combine human and animal DNA was deemed too extreme and shot down immediately. They were, however, put in charge with locating and extracting the protein needed from the Veriforms for use in a commercial drug, which was the initial intent. Saying screw that, the two scientists decide to go ahead with their own project. As you do when your boss who's funding your entire career in research sells you not to. This would ultimately spell their end, but prior to that, after disobeying their superiors and pursuing their own agenda, they would ultimately go on to develop a viable prepubescent female creature. Originally, they had decided that they would terminate the creature before it even got to the point of what was considered birth, so they would stop it before it got full term. And even this was only due to Elsa persuading Clive to let it live past full term. Seems a little strange, doesn't it? Her attachment to a science experiment. And this attachment would ultimately end up not really going her way. Anyhow, after letting it live, and then Elsa trying to figure out if it was violent or not, she would be stung by the creature's tail and go into anaphylactic shock. Which is, if you ever wanted to really know what that is, it's when your blood vessels all dilate kind of at once and your blood pressure drops so low, as well as the narrowing of your breathing passages, causes you to quickly go into shock. The chemical compound that the creature injected causes almost immediate shock, meaning that whatever is growing within this animal is highly toxic to humans. After injecting her with an EpiPen and getting Elsa back, they discover that the creature is not only viable on its own, there is no need to do an autopsy right now as it's aging faster than normal. Minutes are proportioned to be days, so they decide to let it live the rest of its life cycle to study and observe it over the course of its entire life. During this point, it is equated to a child concerning mental capacity, but its brain is developing faster and roughly at the same rate as its body. During a test to determine its cognitive abilities, the creature spells out NERD relating to the shirt Elsa is wearing, so they decide to call the creature Drin as a result. As the creature continues to grow over the next few days, it eventually reaches young child status. The issue begins to crop up that they fear they will be discovered soon, and not to mention, prior to this, the creature attacked Clive's brother after he entered the lab unannounced. The display of aggressive nature would become a massive problem later on. Due to their research wing being small and the creature growing as fast as it was moved to a new location to keep it concealed. After doing so, they noticed a massive spike in temperature. Assuming it was a dangerously high fever, they attempted to place her in a large industrial sink to lower the internal temp. To which we get to our first issue. Clive thinks that this creature should be put down. He fully submerges Drin in the water, but as it turns out, she has amphibious lungs and is able to breathe this water. At first, Elsa appears happy because Clive apparently saved her, but it becomes more clear only moments later that maybe this wasn't a life-saving action. As renovations continued in their wing, the whole place was due to be torn apart and rebuilt. Labs were beginning to be moved, and the area was no longer safe for Drin. They moved her out of the barn and into the woods to continue their work and studies. Up to this point, Drin was given a starchy paste with sucrose to sweeten it. Upon breaking free in the woods, however, Drin quickly hunted down a rabbit and displayed carnivorous taste, as well as an elevated hunting ability, possibly better than that of a natural, homegrown human or other animals in this environment, indicating that she may actually be an apex predator. During this time, their initial experiment with the vermiforms and protein synthesis had also begun to go awry. It appears that Ginger had spontaneously turned male. During a publicized presentation of their work meant to secure future funds, the two creatures were no longer imprinted on one another or even mates at this point. Instead, they were rivals. The two vermiform males attacked one another. The tank was bathed in blood and both were mortally wounded, and in the process, the tank was destroyed, showering prospective financial backers in blood. After this, pressure begins to mount as it does, as their bosses are pretty ticked. Because of this little escapade, they pretty much lost all of their backing, and the project was about to fail. Going back to the barn, Elsa and Clive continued to keep Drin under wraps and confined to this area. While continuing to study her, Clive realizes that the DNA donation from the human side was actually not random, but was in fact one of Elsa's eggs. Elsa at this point begins to treat Drin like a human child and tries to further her bond with her. However, upon discovering a cat that Drin was hiding, she takes it away for fear that she could become sick. During these times, Drin continues to attempt to escape and shows she possesses wings that fold within her skin. This gives her the ability to fly, meaning that she is no longer confined to just hunting on the ground, but can also take to the air. So, things are about to get like a little strange, and you've been warned on this. Eventually, Elsa comes back to her senses and realizes maybe it was cruel to take the cat away. She returns the cat, but by now, alarmingly, Clive and Drin had already begun to form a bond that may not have been exactly platonic. Upon returning the cat, Drin attacks the cat, to which Elsa smacks Drin in anger. Drin retaliates and attacks Elsa, threatening her with her tail dagger before stealing the keys to escape. I mean, Drin almost had it, but then she stops to smell the air and Elsa smacks her in the head with a shovel and knocks her unconscious. After Elsa removes the dagger under the point of classifying it as dangerous misbehavior, Elsa returns to work and then synthesizes the protein using the dagger she pulled from Drin. And holy god, here we go. Clive had returned back to the barn after finding Drin post-surgery. After their almost kiss while dancing earlier, things are getting a little too hot and heavy, and Clive made the ultimate weirdest move I have ever seen and ends up getting kind of frisky with the science experiment. Bro, just why? And then, to make matters worse, I mean, getting caught with a human female and having your human girlfriend walk in is pretty bad. But getting caught with your human hybrid by your human girlfriend, I'm not even really sure there's a way to react to that. So then this sparks a coming to Jesus meeting. Clive accuses Elsa of creating this creature because she wanted control over it. She didn't want a child because there were too many variables, so this was a close second for some reason. And then somehow this works, and she concedes that they were both wrong. My guy, what? Running a DNA analysis on the protein Elsa had given William, they find human DNA. Considering William had expressly forbidden it, this causes him to investigate further. Clive's brother tells him where to find them, and then they both proceed to the barn. During this time, however, Drin had another fever spike, and they assume that she had become bodied by it in the process. They buried her out back of the barn, but after William arrives, Drin was already clawing his way out of the grave. Oh yes, it's a him now. Much like the vermiforms, Drin had now turned into a male and began attacking the group. William and Gavin were almost bodied immediately by the superior hunter. After Elsa takes off, she is then cornered by Drin. And to quote Talladega Nights, she had the old bull, now he wants the young calf.
half.
Well, we will just kind of skip this part because we know what happens. Clive attacks Drin to save Elsa, but Drin overpowers him. Elsa intervenes in this, and just before she's about to take out Drin, she momentarily hesitates due to her bond. This allows Drin to take out Clive with a tail stab to the heart. Clive immediately falls, and then Elsa smacks Drin in the head with a rock, taking him out before leaving her completely alone, but also not alone. Fast forward, and later, Elsa is informed that Drin's body contained numerous biochemical compounds for which the company will be filing patents on. Joanne offers Elsa, who is fairly traumatized by the events that just unfolded and who is also now visibly pregnant with Drin's baby, a large sum of money to bring the baby to term and continue with the pregnancy, which Elsa accepts. So yeah, that thing is totally gonna claw its way out like it did out of the artificial womb it was originally in. So there's a couple of interesting things concerning Drin, but let's take a look at her physiology first and foremost. Drin grows at a very rapid rate and is quite an agile creature, sporting a tail which is revealed to contain a regenerating stinger, two hind legs, as well as missing digit on each hand, and finally revealing wings that she hid within her own skin. She also possesses a barbed hood on the back of her neck, but apart from these, she does not appear that much different from a human, which interestingly and biologically should creep you out. Humans are interesting creatures. You and I possess many quirks, being the species we are, but one that is fairly strange, which goes way back into our folklore of old, is our flat-out hatred of anything that mimics us. Ingrained in humans is the ability to seek out patterns and things that designate the objects around us as either human or non-human. When something falls in the middle of that, our brain is entirely creeped out by this. Something that has always fascinated me is our reaction to these things that fall in this category. And this is why Drin is unsettling. Her almost human appearance almost passes the test of your brain, but not quite, meaning that it is a complete unknown. So this is why things like skinwalkers or wendigos or things like that always creep us out, because they can mimic speech of humans, or they can kind of look human from far away, but they don't move like us. So your brain kind of hits panic mode. But getting back to Drin's physiology, starting with the feet, they are actually hands. Actually, they kind of look somewhat like necromorph feet. Possessing more finger-like extensions than toes, the structuring of the feet and legs are digitigrade as opposed to plantigrade structuring with humans. It appears to be a 70-30 split concerning genetic influence in this area. The structuring itself stemming from more animalistic origins, and the feet and skin stemming from human genetic influence. As the creature ages, the legs stay the same, but proportions change. The legs above the knee become more human and female. Based on what we see surgery-wise, the abdomen, chest, and arms are fairly similar to that of human females. Internally, however, while she does possess lungs like you or I and is able to breathe in air, she also holds a second set of amphibious lungs that are activated as she ages, allowing her to breathe. Obviously, a huge difference is the tail, but it's not so strange concerning humans. Initially, we had tails. And I know you start treading into things like people don't want to hear, but even today, children can still be born with vestigial tails, a leftover trait from long ago. This particular tail houses a stinger capable of injecting toxin that causes immediate anaphylactic shock. Moving down the arms, we find that she is actually missing a finger. This may at some point happen to humans should our pinkies disappear, which it's also time for a side tangent real quick. In my Dark Ones video, I mentioned that we are losing our pinkies, but I don't really fully discuss why. Now, it is possible that once something becomes vestigial enough, it may disappear. It's not guaranteed, but it can happen as it's happened before, like with our tails. It doesn't have a purpose so much, and as a result, we lost it. Now, this is not to say this is always the case. And even now, as I wrote this whole script, I did use my pinky finger to type this. So it does serve a purpose more so now than it might have in the past. So the Dark One video, it is possible and disuse can cause that, but it's always not guaranteed. But all right, anyhow, this would indicate that in Drin, this DNA is not there, meaning that the DNA she does have codes for four fingers as opposed to five. Moving up to the head, we see quite a few physiological changes that are rather interesting. Initially, shortly after birth, the creature appears to have a rodent-like face, surely stemming from mammalian traits. As she grows, a large line continues to show across the middle of the head, which, if you didn't know, when you are forming, you actually have your face come together and meet in the middle. This is why sometimes people get cleft palates, because right around the mouth, it doesn't meet correctly. And that's why also with a cleft palate, you can have the roof of your mouth form unnaturally, because it also didn't meet properly there as well. But anyhow, the eyes face more outwards than they do face forwards. Again, from what I can assume, this comes from amphibious, and then as it ages, it becomes more of a mammalian predator. Through her aging, the eyes will begin to sit more forward, and eventually her face becomes largely human. Hair never forms on top of her head, but apart from that, everything appears to be in place, and she does actually have hair on her skin. So the first thing I wanted to talk about is a life cycle and internal physiology, which brings us to origins. What is Drin actually combined with? Well, clearly, half of the equation is the human egg, and the other half is a little more complicated. This hybridization does not appear to be with human and then a single animal. Instead, I would have to say it's a few animals combined with human DNA. The first one being amphibious, something like frogs. The second animal being a clownfish, and the third animal being something like a scorpion. I know it's kind of convoluted, but based on the presenting traits that are not human, I would narrow it down to these three. We can see the amphibious traits in a few areas. The legs, for instance, do appear to be frog-like, albeit not the same structure. In frog legs, they're more to the outside, but in Drin, they're more underneath, due to human influence and connection of the femur to the pelvis. The toes of frogs are also longer and working off human DNA to create longer toes. This is presented on her feet. The scorpion is fairly obvious. The tail stemming from the back end of Drin and the ability to produce poison. This insect lineage may also give Drin the wings that we see. They are not feathered, and they do not appear to be like bat wings either. Due to this, while scorpions do not have wings, insects' DNA may possess initial DNA for this. And it's also entirely possible that she is mixed with another set of DNA passed to scorpion to produce these wings. And the third animal is a clownfish. And I can hear you. Roanoke, why a clownfish? Because I'm about to ruin Finding Nemo for you. When Drin changes her sex from female to male, this is not actually all that uncommon. In fact, it happens all the time in the animal kingdom. Known as sequential hermaphroditism, these species such as coral reef fishes change their sex as a normal anatomical process. Clownfish, wrasses, moray eels, and other fish do to reproductive functions. In clownfish, if the female at the top of the hierarchy kicks the bucket or disappears, the most dominant male now becomes the female. When this happens, another male becomes the dominant male and mates with the new female, which also explains why Marlin wanted to find Nemo so badly. Judging by the animals Drin is mixed with and the ability to change as such, we actually see key points in the movie where changes happen. Every time Drin got a fever, it's quite alarming to Elsa and Clive. They assume her to become dying to some degree and even assume her bodied at one point. However, I disagree with their assumption. There is this little thing called metabolism. What I believe is happening within Drin during these points of extreme fever is a massive growth of cells and new phenotypic traits. Take the clownfish, for instance. When it is going from male to female, what actually happens is the testicular tissue is completely broken down and recycled, and then there is a massive growth of uterine tissue during this time. So within the artificial womb, Drin flatlines before starting up again and continuing her growth. I believe that this was due to a combination of genes forming within the body. Later during her child phase, before her amphibious lungs come in, she has a massive spike in temperature. As the body changes and cells grow, this produces heat. And because of this, they submerge her and then discover that she has this trait, though they had no idea she had it. And I base this whole argument off of the context clues, but also her final fever. It appears as though she's about to kick the bucket, but much like her first flatline in the artificial womb, this is no different. After a massive spike in temperature and an apparent flatline, she is buried and then becomes male. With a new gene switching on, this would produce a massive influx in different hormones such as testosterone and phenotypic changes within Drin's face and body, as well as such growth of new gear in the lower half of her body and an increase in muscle with perhaps the addition of new organs within her body and more specifically the formation of gonads. Fact is, Drin was never really sick, her body was just undergoing changes. And this would indicate that her life cycle is as such. Much like humans in the womb, organs begin to form to what our sex is. When a sperm and egg combine, you are either male or female. And nowadays, that's a pretty controversial statement, as there are some outliers to that. There can be genetic issues that arise, which cause you to form both or really neither. But with Drin, however, she was neither male nor female until the initial flatline and subsequent restart where she became female. After she had aged, she would begin to exhibit traits and form new organs as she matured. During maturation, she could reach a point where it was possible to mate with other males if she existed within a group of older males. But considering humans were the only game in town, she ended up mating with Clive. After full maturation, she finally becomes a male at the end of her life cycle and spreads his genes as opposed to spreading others' genes. And this happens in the animal kingdom quite a bit, and because of this, it's a possibility. After becoming male, she mates with Elsa, but this would likely go very terribly. Females can only donate the X chromosome during reproduction. So even as a base, Drin being male means that the Y chromosome chromosome had recombinated elsewhere. So likely the baseline X is still there from Elsa. And it's not really shown if the baby within her is male or female, but judging by the life cycle of Drin, that would mean that this creature is female, which means whatever Elsa is carrying is not only an abomination, but likely an inbred one at that. So holy hell, this movie got really dark really quick. But if you enjoyed it, or at least I hope you guys did, it would be great if you leave a like and maybe sub if you're new, because it's a great way to stay up to date on when I post. I'll drop my Twitter, Twitch, Discord, Patreon, second and third channel links in the description if you guys are interested in that. And I'd also like to thank a few of my patrons. Huge shout out to Trey Windenall, our astronaut. Also want to thank our residents, James Wiley, Nahili, because I got it right that time, Robert Plattner, Some Red Dude, and Vincent Garcia. And to the rest of my patrons, you are greatly appreciated. To be real, things on the old YouTube are super unstable right now, and your help goes a long way towards keeping things in balance, so I really do appreciate that. All right, so that's gonna do it for me. I appreciate you guys watching, and I will see y'all in the next one.